Why don't we watch another vignette?
Larry, why don't you have a seat?
My name's Nikki. I'm one of the nurses, and I need to ask you a few questions about what brought you to the emergency department today. I also need to take your blood pressure and put this thing on your finger.
My wife brought me to the emergency department. She's all worried. She thinks I'm having a heart attack because I have this pain. It's not really pain, more like a pressure, like something sitting on my chest.
Okay. Do you have this pressure right now?
Yeah.
All right. Now, do you have any medical problems that you see a doctor regularly for?
Just my high cholesterol. But he put me on a medication, an anti-cholesterol drug. It's much better now.
What were you doing when this pressure started?
Sleeping. Woke me right up. Hasn't gone away.
All right. What time was that?
About 6 a.m.
6 o'clock. Do you feel short of breath at all?
Kinda.
All right. How about your stomach? Do you feel sick to your stomach?
A little queasy.
A little queasy. All right. I need a wheelchair to triage, and I'm going to be taking that last monitored bed. Larry, how old are you?
52.
I have a wheelchair, and then I'm going to have you have a seat in, and your wife can go ahead and get you registered into the emergency department.
This 52-year-old male has multiple risk factors for cardiac disease: obesity, smoking, and high cholesterol. He presents to the emergency department with chest pressure that woke him up from sleep, with nausea, shortness of breath, and diaphoresis. His heart rate is between 30 and 40 and irregular. His respiratory rate is rapid, and his blood pressure is low, 90 over 76. This patient is probably having an acute MI. He needs to be seen immediately and immediate life-saving interventions initiated. He needs IV access, fluid, pacing pads in place, and other hemodynamic interventions. He meets criteria for ESI level 1.
Interesting case. Mm-hmm. What do you think? Do you agree, ESI level 1?
Oh, absolutely. Definitely.
Mm-hmm. He may not agree. The patient may not agree.
But, you know, the denial is along with the diagnosis.
Oh, that's an excellent point. Mm-hmm. Did you notice how diaphoretic he was?
Yes. That was one of the first things I noticed.
Yeah, that across this room assessment really made you key in on that. He had so many risk factors.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why didn't I just walk him back to to a treatment room?
Because activity increases his myocardial oxygen demand. So you would want him to rest and get oxygen in.
That's an excellent point. Mm-hmm. We really need to do that.
Mm-hmm. He's also bradycardic, and I think he was also had hypotension. His blood pressure was low, too, so
yes,
that's another red flag.
Great, and that's really the thing that makes him a level 1 versus a 2, because you really don't want to make all of your chest pains level 2. If you start making all your chest pains level 2, then people really aren't going to be paying attention to level 1s.
Mm-hmm.
He was a level 1 because he was bradycardic. Most chest pains, the nurse can manage just fine for the first 10, 15 minutes. You put them on the monitor, you get your access, you get your labs, you get your EKG, and you really don't need a physician at the bedside. This patient who's at bradycardic and hypotensive, you want to bring the doc to the bedside because you may start doing more than those things. And the things we talked about, the pacer pads, all of that is really good. Still with all that, he looks pretty good. And I know I would have been surprised when I found his heart rate was 30. I would not have originally pictured that I would have been making him level 1. That was the one thing that would have made me change my mind.
Mm-hmm. Especially since he brought in that can of soda. He was pretty active.
He had so many risk factors, and, you know, it's true. ESI level 1, you know, my concern would be getting him back into that resuscitation room before he arrested.
Exactly.
Me too. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Good.